Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, RV, boat, motorcycle, whatever it may be. Check it out at Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. And remember that with Purdy Insurance, they'll do everything they can to save you money. The customer always comes first. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Time now to open the show, and I did receive a complaint text on Friday that we did not open the show with the Matt Cotrillo rant of the day.
I know, I couldn't believe it.
Well, it was from Lisa Cotrillo.
Get the lingerie on the deck, call the janitor.
Well, yeah, because it was a crazy sports weekend. There's a lot to rant about. So, first, I'll start with the Sixers game. Because, well, I guess for two reasons. One, I don't think I've ever felt so irked by a crazy, wild, what ended up being a happy ending for the Sixers. Because it shouldn't have been that close. It shouldn't have come down to the way it was. It shouldn't have been as painful to watch down the stretch as it should have been. And it's giving me zero confidence that they can win two more games against the Celtics team to go on to the Eastern Conference Final. I mean, they played scared in that second half yesterday and got lucky multiple times that the Celtics screwed up their final shot and couldn't get it off in time. And there were a couple other times that the Celtics, when they were hitting shots down the stretch, didn't with the game on the line. I mean, it's that simple.
Well, I'll be honest with you. James Harden needed to hit that shot. What did he end up with, 39?
42.
42? That's because he personally gave up 41 in the game. He is an awful
yes,
defender.
Yes, he is. He is god-awful.
He can't guard the suit.
No. Right? He could even guard me.
And the suit, the suit can't move.
Exactly right. Not only that, actually, I'll argue he gave up at least 43 because the possession before he hit the game-winning three, he was literally at the cup about to go up for a layup and then passed off the ball to Embiid. And Embiid missed a shot. And luckily, they got another opportunity. Like, what are you doing? Take the ball. Don't be afraid. Take the ball. That was the whole second half of the Sixers yesterday, playing scared. Whatever they did in the late first quarter through the second quarter went away in the second half for whatever reason. And you got Doc Rivers calling weird timeouts again. When you finally get a transition bucket that actually is going to be a layup, the Sixers missed several of those that could have also put the game away or at least helped put the game away. You finally get one in open court. Doc calls a timeout because he's upset with Melton, as he should be. But don't call a timeout. Earth to Doc. Tobias Harris was wide open underneath the other basket. So there was that. I'm still happy they won. It was a great moment. Harden had a great moment with John Howe after the game. You know, we'll get into that. But the way they played the game, the Sixers did not deserve to win that game yesterday. But they got lucky, and I will see what happens in the final three games of the series. But my confidence is still not great that they can win this series. And then secondly, Jason Tatum not being called for a push-off offensive foul that gave the Celtics the lead late in overtime is egregious. It's an embarrassment. And again, that official should not be near a playoff game. I mean, that's as egregious of a push-off as you can get. We've argued different things of what's an offensive foul, what isn't, what do you call, what do you not call. The guy flat-out shoved him down on the ground and made the shot. And there was no whistle. And the official was right there. I don't get it. I give up with this officiating in the NBA playoffs. At least in this series, it's been downright, it's just been just as bad, if not worse, as James Harden's defense.
There's no question that's an offensive foul. He shoved him. He extended the arm, created space. Should have been an offensive foul. I'm trying to figure out in the NBA what's walking, because I feel like Embiid walks a ton.
That's everybody though. That's Embiid. That's LeBron. Yeah, that's X star here. Yeah,
he is egregious.
You know what? And now, he's still at 34-13. But if you can call it a quiet game, I would characterize it as that, because Al Horford got the best of him down the stretch. That can't happen. I'm sorry.
Well, Horford is, to his credit, the definition of a wily veteran. I've said my praise for Al Horford over the years on the show has been, there is a guy that knows how to play basketball.
Absolutely.
All right. And that is a problem. He's a smart guy that knows how to play. And Embiid is playing like a guy who's out of shape. He didn't look like he's in shape. He's running out of gas. I don't care how many minutes he's logging. I'm sorry. He looks tired.
Well, I think part of that is he did not run at all when he was rehabbing his knee. And the Sixers threw him right back in there for game three.
No offense. He's played three games in a row. He's played games 2, 3, and 4. He looks like he's out of shape. That's not good in the month of May. Then there's the Jokic play.
Oh, geez. And that's where I'm going to next, yes. But you go ahead.
Never should have been called for a technical.
No,
never.
Absolutely not. And this goes just like the NFL. If he gets any sort of penalty, whether it's a fine, suspension, whatever, the NBA, again, can no longer say it cares about his players, especially when it comes to dealing with the crowd that close to the court. I'm sorry. That was a joke.
If Ishbia is not the owner, if Matt Ishbia is not the owner, he actually gets thrown out. But because he is the owner, he did not get thrown out.
He should be suspended at least for the next game, if not the rest of the series, and fined heavily, like $500,000 or more. The NBA should put the hammer down on this guy. And to be quite honest with you, he should be watching himself, because guess what? His front office that he just took over isn't in the greatest limelight right now after the whole sexual abuse allegations from the previous ownership.
Right, but he has nothing to do with that.
Yeah, but he's not helping his team, though.
Yeah, but I'm saying, but he has nothing to do with that. One is not related to the other.
But I'll give him credit. He did say today it would not be good if Jokic, or not be fair, or whatever he said, if Jokic got a suspension or anything like that. So at least he said that.
He knows he played. Yeah, he didn't play in the league, obviously. He was a walk-on at Michigan State,
correct,
but he played. So he knows what it's like to be in the heat of the battle. I mean, he knows. I mean, he has a national championship ring with a bunch of guys that did go on to the NBA. So,
So between those couple things, that's what got me all fired up today.
Yeah. All right. I don't know if we're going to have the schedule release on Thursday or not, but there are rumors that the NFL is going to have a Christmas Day triple header. on Monday, December 25th. So historically, when Christmas has fallen on a Monday, the NFL has scheduled two games for the occasion. It did in 2006 and in 2017. The NFL has scheduled a total of six Christmas Day games over the past 3 years. 1-20, 2-21, and 3-22. They all registered gigantic TV ratings. Last year's game between the Packers and the Dolphins was one of the 10 most watched regular season games at 25.9 million viewers. Now remember, it won't be on next year. I'm talking about the 24 season. Remember, next year's leap year. Okay? Which means instead of being on Tuesday, Christmas is going to be on a Wednesday. So that changes everything. But they're talking about a Christmas triple header, a game on Black Friday in the afternoon. But because of all the moving parts that has dealt with player personnel movement, Aaron Rodgers late going to the Jets, Lamar Jackson late signing with Baltimore. That's why it's not assured that the schedule releases on Thursday, because they're still trying to get moving parts. Oh yeah, and plus DeAndre Swift signed with the Eagles. That was the other one. No, nothing to do with it. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I love the move, but yeah, I'm going to say no on that one.
There's nothing to do with it? He's hurt all the time. Right? It's like you keep relying on guys that get hurt. If he plays more than 10 games, I'll be shocked. But yeah. So we don't know if the schedule release is going to be on Thursday. We are still waiting. Because it, you know, let's start with this. You know the last time I watched the schedule release?
No, senor! No, senor! No, senor!
Never.
That's because you're a party pooper.
I'm not a party pooper. I see when they who's on the schedule when they tell you in January. And anybody can figure it out. I mean, just you can figure out what a dozen of the matchups by the fourth quarter of your last game. The only thing you don't know is which division you get in the other conference. I don't watch the schedule release.
Well, truthfully, I don't actually watch the release either, because everything's already leaked on Twitter, so maybe I'll watch the first couple minutes of it usually, just to confirm a few things that I've heard to make sure, you know, what I heard is correct. But I mean, you hear a majority of the schedule beforehand with people leaking it.
Well, man. And if you want to watch it, that's great. I mean, anybody can do whatever they want. But no offense, I have no interest in it. In fact, when I finally do sit down, like I look at the schedule, you know what the first thing I look at is? No idea.
Probably not much.
No, every year. I always look at the first one thing, first time, every time. I'd like to see who the three games on Thanksgiving happen to be. Because I'd say, I don't know, 6 out of 10 times I'm home. All right. On Thanksgiving. So I would just like to see, you know, who's going to be, you know, who's playing. That usually is the first thing I look at. I don't think I'm home on Thanksgiving this year, though. Because I think that Orlando tournament is Thanksgiving Friday and Sunday around the Michigan State football game. So I'm not so sure. I don't think so. Because the last time I did the Orlando tournament, we did play on Thanksgiving. So, last year the Jets had one primetime game without Aaron Rodgers. This year, each team can be scheduled for 6 primetime regular season games, with the league option of flexing a team into a 7th. Expect the Jets to have a minimum of 5, possibly 6. And the Ravens are going to get multiple primetime games as well with Lamar Jackson. The other part is which game will Arizona and Tampa Bay get? Because they're only going to be home once. And they're going to be more Monday night doubleheaders this year. And by the way, I think Chris Fowler is going to be the one calling it.
Yes. Our buddy Andrew Barshan reported that late last week. He's replacing Steve Levy.
Not Steve Levy. So, there you go. All right, we'll take a break. We'll go back to the Cauldron of Hate in a moment. What? Here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
There's something to be said about a sale with a handshake. A service technician who really knows what he's doing. They can explain it in English what the problem is. There's nothing better than having that friend you could trust in the area. That's Sunbury Motors, where you get selection, knowledgeable salespeople, and prices that fit your budget, and more important, that friend you can trust. Welcome to Sunbury Motors, Kia, Ford, and Hyundai. You could shop other dealers and compare prices, but at Sunbury Motors, you get their lowest price promise. They research the current used vehicle market and guarantee their used car prices are the lowest. If you find a lower price, Sunbury Motors will beat it. 3 dealers all in one. See their full new and pre-owned inventory at sunburymotors.com. Pick out a vehicle you like and schedule your test drive online. Follow them on Facebook. Sunbury Motors Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
I sense you're not done yet.
No. We've gotten through most of it with those two things in the NBA, but there's still a few things out there.
It's interesting. As everyone knows, I work ahead on the season. I got to Michigan State today. 20 players transferring out, 16 in. Wow.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show is brought to you by Purdy Insurance. Market Street in Sunbury, go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, RV, boat, motorcycle, bundles. They'll do everything they can to save you money and make sure you're fully insured. Customer service means everything to them. At Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. I mentioned earlier, before we closed out the previous segment, about Michigan State. And the second year, that Mel Tucker was there, they went all in on the transfer portal, getting 20 players from the portal, 15 of them from Power 5 schools, including Kenneth Walker, and it paid off in an 11-2 season and winning the Peach Bowl. Last year, they had 25 transfer out, brought in 9. This year, they've had 20 transfer out and brought in 16. Now, you can do it any way you want, and sometimes it has to be done by necessity. Obviously, Mike Rhodes is in that spot right now for Penn State basketball. He has no incoming recruiting class because they all left when Micah went to Notre Dame. He's had two other players transfer out, Evan Mahaffey to Ohio State and Kebijai to Notre Dame. Plus, he's had Dalian Johnson go to Florida Gulf Coast and Caleb Dorsey to William & Mary. So he has had no choice except to go to the transfer portal. That is his only way of putting together a team. So that aside, we hear a lot, and a word that we have heard repeatedly for 10 years now across the country is culture, over and over. And usually it is accompanied by one word in front of it, quote, our culture. And I brought this up before, but it's worth bringing it up again, because the basketball transfer portal closes on Thursday. The football transfer portal for non-graduates closed on April 30th. I'm all for whatever you can do with the transfer portal, but to me, how can you possibly develop that all-important culture, that locker room, that camaraderie? How can you develop that when there's interchangeable parts all the time? And that's the part I'm not quite there when it comes to mass transfers. And again, with Penn State basketball, they have no choice this time through. So that part I got. But I don't see how you can develop that. I think it takes a lot of work to do that. Now, if you start winning with it, it's amazing how quickly it will develop. But it's something that I look at, and Dick Girardi and I were talking about the basketball side of it. And I mentioned to him that only two of the transfers Penn State brought in, Wahab and O'Boyle, were one and done. Everybody else have multiple years to go. Some 2, 1, 3. Okay. And Dick said, yeah, we'll see. He says, Steve, I feel like right now we're on a year-by-year basis. And I think there's a lot of truth to what Dick said when we talked about it. That you feel like everything is almost on a year-by-year basis. You appreciate a Kanye Clary staying. You appreciate a Jermeil Brown staying. You appreciate a Demetrius Lilly staying. Now, in football, I pointed out with James Franklin, they have been selective in the transfer portal, which I think is what Mike wants to do, Mike Rhodes. I think Mike wants to be selective as well. But right now, he has no choice. And the players he's been able to bring in the portal have helped. Hunter Norzad, your starting center, he's helped. Okay. You've got Johnny Dixon. I'll go back to what I said before the Rose Bowl. When Clark Phillips said he was going to the draft and would not play for Utah. And Joey Porter Jr. said he was going to the draft and would not play for Penn State in the Rose Bowl. I said on this show a couple of times and in other interviews, the difference is Penn State has Johnny Dixon and Utah does not. And Johnny Dixon played a great Rose Bowl, and Penn State was able to get to that Utah secondary. But Johnny Dixon's a transfer. Chop Robinson, terrific player. In the past, they've had an Arnold Ebiketie who was transferring it. Mitchell Tinsley. And we all know that Dante Cephas is going to be here in, what, a week? Something like that. All right? And they've been selective about it. And that allows the culture to build, because part of the recruiting is that the recruiting has to come not just from the coaches, not just from the head coach, not just from the recruiting staff. It also has to come from the players. The players are critical to your ability to recruit, because they are the ones that they'll sit down and say, hey, what's it really like here? And you go from there. I don't know. I was going through it today, and I got Michigan State done. Ironically, as I was doing it, they got to transfer a defensive back from TCU. But I don't see how you can build a culture when it's a constant turning over. Now, I know in professional sports you have a turnover. You know, you have free agency, the draft, and so forth. But let's take your team, the Eagles. They've got their quarterback. They got their tight end still. They got most of the offensive line back. They got the two great wideouts in Brown and Smith. Still got Fletcher Cox. Still got Darius Slay, despite your complaints. You know, they have the vast majority of the core back, and then they've added in around the core, but they've kept the core together. In college sports, when I see 20 out and 16 in, Michigan State core, part of the core was their quarterback and their top wideout, and they both left. When your top wide receiver and your quarterback both leave, that's not good. They have three tight ends on that team. All three tight ends are transfers. Top four running backs, three of the four are transfers. Now, maybe Mel Tucker brings it all together like he did 2 years ago and makes it happen. But to me, that just screams desperation. That's just me. And I don't quite... not quite on board with it. Again, when it's necessary, it's necessary. Again, Mike Rhodes has no option. Yeah, okay, we'll just stick with what we have. Well, what you have are three scholarship players and two walk-ons. I think you need more guys. And obviously Mike felt the same way. Time now to go back to the hate desk.
Well, my hate desk can never upstage the great Frank Bodani from the York Daily Record, who's...
Oh, that's right. We have Frank on today. My apologies. Sorry about that.
On the line with us now.
So. Hey, guys.
Hey, Frank. How are you?
Really good. Really good. How are you? How are things going? I enjoyed the transfer talk.
Yeah. I mean, I just don't see how you they talk about culture, but, you know, I mean, everywhere. I just don't see how you make it happen, Frank.
No, but you know what? Especially in college football today, there's a lot of pressure to try to win, right? Coaches have a small window.
Oh.
And Big Ten East, that window is even tighter. So I guess I can kind of see if there's an avenue, right? There's going to be some desperation. Maybe that's the right word. Because it did work.
Yeah.
But, man, you're walking tightrope, and you're not building for long term that way, obviously. Can't.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, the guy that's really paying his salary at Michigan State, we saw him go toe-to-toe with Jokic last night, so that's Mat Ishiba. So, but, you know, this is an interesting time where things have, quote, settled down a bit. So what are you seeing in this, quote, settle down period about Penn State now you've had a chance to really assess it?
Well, I mean, Penn State, their transfer hit rate is pretty impressive.
Yes, it is.
And I think they've done it the way where they've accentuated their team. I don't know how much better you can do. I mean, Chop Robinson is incredible, and I think when you take a step back at looking at this team coming out of spring football, to me, the possibilities on defense, I mean, in particular, I think when, you know, there's a lot of upside is when was, you know, they have the chance to me to become one of the best, more dynamic Penn State defenses, but certainly under Franklin, and I think you go back even beyond that. That's the potential. And I think you can say that because of what they've painstakingly put together, and I think it's what you mentioned too. It's continuity and culture. You don't get to where they're at right now with a quick fix. Chop Robinson is just something you know, a guy like him, guy like maybe a cornerback they bring in, that's just the finishing pieces, you know.
I agree. And it turns out that all the quarterbacks are recruited. So when you watch, you know, I know the blue-white game and anything else you had a chance to see. What's your thought on the two kids?
Oh, well, we know Beau Pribula a little more intimately because he's from York, you know.
Yep.
And just loves his makeup and demeanor, which I don't think you can oversell at that position what that means. You know, I think still – and I think his his grit and in things like strength training, and I mean, there is, you're not going to get someone who's going to work harder, and he's not going anywhere. I mean, this is his dream place, so get asked that a lot by Penn State fans. I don't think he's going anywhere, so I think he's a great number two guy right now battling for number one. And I think, you know, Drew Aller just, he just has to have the chance to me to be the number one guy and do it, right? I mean, we've seen him play, but we've never seen him play when the game has been yet to be decided other than once, right, against Purdue. And I think he just needs, like, how much can you grow into what you can be without getting a chance to do it that way? He just needs that. I think we saw the possibilities from the arm and everything at the blue-white game. And, you know, I think he's and what they're doing, right, Steve, is they're, even in transfers, they're putting everything they need in place to help him. Yeah. You know, you have to have that extra running back. To me, they got it. Who knows how good Dante Cephas could be, but you need another guy to challenge in that room for sure, and you get him. And, you know, when's the last time Penn State had a guy like the left tackle coming back? When? I don't know when.
Yeah, probably not since.
Is a special product.
Probably not since Brown, who ended up going to the Cardinals in the first round.
Yeah. Yes. So not.
You know, I mean, that's. No, not recently. And remember, everybody was mad he moved from defensive tackle.
Well, Joe convinced him what his upside was going to be, right, when he was recruited.
Right, but everybody was mad. How can they move this guy? How can they move this guy? This guy's starting for years in the NFL. What the heck?
I think they're in the best place, to me, since James Franklin's took over, even though the Big Ten East is probably the toughest it's ever been since Shane Franklin took over. But to me, I thought when they played Ohio State last year, I saw a Penn State team that pretty much matched up better on the front lines than they had in the past. And I think that's only going to be better when you deal with elite teams this coming year. So it's like, maybe to a lot of fans, it's like the season can't get here quick enough this time, you know.
Right, yeah. And that's probably the case. Do you ever learn anything out of the blue-white game?
That's a really good question. I don't know what to say about learning. I think what you learn is, like, okay, I look at Tony Rojas, the young linebacker. So you hear about him. You hear about a guy who just got there. We could never have seen him before because he literally just arrived in January. So I think a guy like that, you might learn something. Like, is he – what's he like compared to the talk? You know, I think there's at least some gauge you can get. And then you see him up close in person and physically, wow. Yeah, he put on the 30 pounds and he looks like he's ready to play Big Ten football today and be good at it, like physically. Like, that checks out. That's not just talk. And then you do see him fly around and make tackles. I know it's against his own team, but you see it. And I think a guy like that is what I think I learned the most from. Like, that's legitimate. He looks like someone you're not going to be able to keep out of the lineup.
Any thoughts on the rules they're putting in place to keep the clock moving?
Well, I mean, do you think it's too long right now? I'm a reporter. I like the break, Steve. It helps me.
the breaks pay our salary, so I'm not. Yeah. So,
they can take as long as they want.
Yeah. I mean, I'll say this. The Penn State-Purdue game, the last play, as exciting as the game was, I remember it was 12:04 when the final play went, because Jack made a comment to me and asked, "What time is it?" And I looked over at my phone. I said, "It's 12:04." That means from the kickoff to then was like 3 hours and 52 minutes.
Well, that is a little long. Maybe they could do it more like the blue-white game. How long was that this year? Hour and 52 minutes?
If that.
I think you're right in that there's certainly certain games, especially when they start at, after 8 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
That gets to be dragged on too long. So, yeah, I mean, it's a good point because no one needs to be up at midnight watching games. Really. I mean, so anything to do to, I guess, help quicken things, especially, you know, the end of games and the end of the halves, which just, that's brutal sometimes. I mean, the clock stops every 5 minutes and the last, 5 minutes of the half takes sometimes a half an hour. So it doesn't seem like that, though, when you're either there covering it, though, writing about it. I'm certainly sure it doesn't seem like that when you're playing it.
Right. Maybe just I don't think about it too much. It just turned out he made the comment to me, and I looked down and went, oh, yeah, it's a little late. Because we're not sitting there looking at our watches during the game. I got to ask you one more question about Beau, because he's from your area.
Mm-hmm.
What do the fans think about him and the situation here?
The local fans, you mean?
Yep.
I think they're excited. I think they, because really, I don't know if there's ever been a quarterback from our league in the YAIAA who's ever been a full-time scholarship quarterback at Penn State. So it's a new thing. I mean, we get players once in a while that go up there, but not a quarterback. And I think in this day and age, I think everybody, though, like, I'll go back to it, they always ask, is he going to stay? Because, transfers are more and more frequent, and especially at that position, only one guy can do it pretty much at a time. But they're excited. I think they saw continually how athletic he was, and meaning that how he could win games and help his team in so many different ways. And I think, if anything, I saw from the blue-white game was his speed running, like knowing where he was, if he was going to roll out to the outside, getting from point A to point B. I think when you watch him in person playing a game, he's faster doing that. Not running in a straight line necessarily. I'm talking about like making up his mind and go from left to right and go here to there. I think he's quicker than you realize, and he might be quicker and better at doing that than any quarterback Penn State's had. I think maybe, you know, because that's a different type of quickness and speed. And I think that kind of athleticism gets people excited as to what he can do to defenses. I you know, it's a wait and see. I mean, you know, he's coming in at the same time as a Drew Aller, of all things, right? So I think it's a different than if he came in literally at any other time, because Penn State doesn't get a lot of five-star quarterbacks with the kind of height that Drew does, has had, you know. So I think it's, hey, let's see what Drew can do, but we're glad we have this guy from Pennsylvania there too, New York, you know.
Oh, I believe me. You watch Bo on an everyday basis. You're a fan. So,
I mean, a different type of quarterback. I mean, he doesn't have the arm type of skill that Drew does, but a different type. And if they can find a way to use him appropriately at the same time in games that when they matter, which I think they could if they want, I mean, that's going to only, you know, that's going to make their offense that much tougher. I mean, you can't defend their T formation, to me, right now, to begin with. They can almost run the whole game on that, I think. When you have Nick Singleton and Katron Allen and the tight ends they do, that might be the most impressive thing on the offense. I don't know if I saw any one time where a defense knew anything of what they were doing with that formation. And you might want to say, you remember how much Saquon Barkley improved between his first and second year on campus.
Yeah.
And to me, these running backs, you know, you saw that people were excited, but to me, it's like that's what makes this team special heading into this coming year, is not that these – it's look, those guys can get better and markedly so. Saquon got markedly faster between his first year and second year. He got caught from behind his first year. I don't know if he ever got caught from behind again in a Penn State uniform, because he was in the training session for an entire year. And I think these guys – or some of their best players are their youngest, them and Abdul Carter, for example, and I think they can do more and be better than they were last year. And I think that's what people don't maybe will understand until they see it.
Frank, always a pleasure, my friend. Thank you so much.
Hey, love talking. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
Frank Bodani, York Daily Record. Back next half hour, play-by-play call of the day and more. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.